to this special edition of YouthSpeak, an exhibition debate that promises to take us on an exhilarating intellectual journey. I am honored to be your host today. This exhibition debate aims to showcase the exceptional English critical thinking abilities of Taiwanese youth. Since 2015, the National High School English Debate Tournament has become a platform that encourages students to develop comprehensive policy proposals, evaluate their disadvantages and advantages, and present persuasive arguments to support their positions. For policy debate, we have assembled a group of students who have excelled in the 2023 National Tournament. For the affirmative side, we have Ms. Li Zhizhen and Ms. Xu Yifeng, and the debaters, Cai Shiqian, Zhang Kesen, Lin Zhishuo, and Li Chenhao from the affiliated Zhongli Senior High School of National Central University. Cai Shiqian and Zhang Kesen will represent the school today. For the negative side, let's welcome the coach, Ms. Olivia Wei, with the debaters, Chen Yanfu, Lin Xingchuan, and Li Yilun from Minder Senior High School. The former two will be the representatives. Now, allow me to introduce our distinguished panel of judges. First, we have Mr. Nathan Weller from Taipei Private Zaixing School, Mr. Michael Zhen, lecturer from National Zhengzhi University, Mr. Eric Xu, former debater and a graduate from London School of Economics with a master's degree in public policy. They'll use their expertise in policy debate to provide insights and feedback at the end of the debate. Get ready to be inspired by these eloquent young debaters. The proposition for today's debate is that Taiwan's compulsory military training should include both men and women.
First, affirmative constructive speech, 5 minutes.
Honorable judges and fellow debaters, today we, the affirmative, strongly advocate that Taiwan's compulsory military training should include both men and women. Our first contention is inherency. The Military Service Act conflicts with the 7th and the 20th Article of the Constitution. The 20th Article of the Constitution states that all citizens have an obligation to serve in the military. However, the first article of the Military Service Act only requires men to serve in the military. Constitution is the foundation of all laws, hence, no law should violate it. The 7th article of the Constitution guarantees equal rights for all people despite any differences. However, the Military Service Act does not meet the outcome of gender equality. Defending our country should not only be men's job. Women are capable of doing it too. We have three solid pieces of evidence to prove that recruiting women can enhance military strength. The first piece of evidence is from a paper collaborating with the Norwegian military by randomly placing women with men in the boot camp. The questionnaires interview men at three stages, before and after the end of the boot camp and 6 months after the boot camp, the military service. Using a meticulous methodology, Gordon Dow shows that drafting women into the military doesn't reduce combat performance. The second evidence collaborated with the Norwegian Institute for Defense Study. In the study, the male soldiers who have worked with women believe women have balanced things out and create a more communicative and positive environment. The third piece of evidence is from a thesis by a major from South Korea. About 97% of the male respondents in the Navy think female performance is as similar as and even better than men. Only 3.3% of the respondents distrusted female combat performance. Our second contention is low birth rate significance. MND has provided various incentives to enlist more voluntary soldiers, but its goal of a 90% ratio of actual strength to authorized strength has never been reached. The chief reason is the low birth rate. The former chief of the General Staff Admiral Li Xinming confessed that if MND had known the present severity of the low birth rate, it wouldn't have shrunk the number of military personnel and implemented the bi-track military service in the 1990s. Last year's World Population Review shows that our population growth rate is 0.14%, ranking 182 globally. According to the Department of Household Registration Statistics, Taiwan recorded a negative population growth for the first time in 2020. The number of deaths was more than the number of births. In addition to insufficient voluntary soldier, compulsory military service faces the same difficulties. Take last year as an example. Men born in 2003 would be drafted into the military in 2022, but its number was only 118,000, down by 10,500 from the previous year. Worse still, According to the National Development Council, negative population growth rate will be permanent. It will cause significant harm to the future military strength. However, if we drop women into the military, we can counter the significance of the shortage of military personnel. Our third contention is the emergency of a war. There are many signs showing that PLA, People's Liberation Army, will launch a full-scale invasion of Taiwan. Sign 1, Chinese President Xi will likely resolve the Taiwan issue within his terms. Sign 2, former commander of Indo-Pacific Command, Phil Davidson, and chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff General Mark Milley testified in Congress that PLA will have the ability to launch an amphibious attack by 2027. Sign 3, the deterrence the U.S. can impose on China has been weakest since the Korean War, CSIS, the Center for Strategic and International Studies, ran 22 simulations last year. The U.S. consistently loses in the war games between Taiwan and China in the Western Pacific. Sign 4, before 2018, for 70 years, the U.S. only enacted two acts with Taiwan. However, in the past 4 years, there have been 4 new acts passed. America actively interacting with Taiwan demonstrates that China is seen as a pacing threat to the U.S. However, if we recruit women, we can send 2 powerful signals to both the internal and international world. Soldiers in Taiwan have low social status, and general citizens have a misconception that defending the territory is only a professional soldier's task. This is elaborated in a book called Overall Defense Concept released last year by the former chief of the General Staff Admiral. By drafting women, the misconception can be gradually changed. As for the signal to the international world, RAND, a U.S. think tank, analyzes the complicated diplomatic relations in the Western Pacific. When the war breaks out, most neighboring countries will not go to help Taiwan unless Thai administration can make a drastic military change to show the world that Taiwan cares so much about protecting its own sovereignty. Conscripting women in the military will be an unmistakable signal. Our main plan includes rectifying the law, a mixed gender camp, strengthening enforcement, and a new division to cope with the potential problems. It is the end of my speech. Thank you.
Second negative cross-exams, first affirmative. 3 minutes.
Fellow debaters, thank you for your speech. Below is the second negative cross-examination. So first, I would like to ask some questions. You mentioned that the military act violates constitution, is that correct?
Yes.
Then, did you know when did the constitution been set?
100 years ago.
So, since it has been so such a long time, well, it's still valid, no?
No, but because it is set so long time ago,
yeah.
So the society might change during this hundreds of years. So it's time for we to really use the constitution.
Since you also agree that it might not be valid, then why do you just say that because of the acts outweigh the constitution?
No, but
we need to change.
Society has changed over this time, so we should include women into the military.
All right, thank you. Then the second aspect is about the evidence you provide to prove that women have the ability. Is that you use the evidence that's come from Navy, is that correct?
They're from Navy and also Army. We have 3 evidence. One is Gordon Dow collaborated with the Norwegian.
Yes, I would just focus on the Navy one. Is that you use the evidence that's come from Navy. However, you are going to increase the amount of compulsory soldiers. However, those compulsory
soldiers. The military society and the physical test they are going to take on is similar.
No, I mean that the compulsory soldiers will not work on the aspects of Navy. But you use the evidence that is about Navy to prove that women have the ability. Is that your evidence still valid?
It is valid because it focuses on the physical strength. And physical strengths do not change.
All right, thank you. And you also mentioned that the low birth rate is one of the reasons because you will face lack of soldiers in the future, is that correct?
Yes.
Then how many soldiers do you think will be enough?
Oh, well, we don't have an exact number, but now the ratio has never been reached. So we think that a soldier is not enough in Taiwan. And so if we recruit women into the military, we can counter this problem.
Since you don't have a goal, how can I know that? So how many is enough or just that is lack of soldiers. You know, that's a problem that you mentioned.
You mean like the exact number of?
Just actually, you at least you need to have.
So there are now 80,000 conscripts per year.
Yes.
So we are going to like recruit more soldiers.
So more soldiers as possible. Is that correct in your plan?
We have when you have a proper number, like we draft women from age 18 to 36. So it's like the status quo.
All right, thank you. And also, you mentioned that, so in your plan, you are going to you are going to have more and more women. However, will you have enough equipment for them?
We will. So the equipment is in the National Defense Council as well.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
First, negative constructive speech, 5 minutes.
Honorable judges, we, the negative team, strongly disagree that Taiwan's compulsory military training should include both men and women. During the cross-examination, the affirmative team admitted that the constitution is made long time ago and the society might change. Therefore, should not be conflicted to the constitution. It's the constitution that needs to be changed. And they used the evidence from the Navy to prove that the physical strength has no difference. However, the Navy in Taiwan is composed of voluntary soldiers, which will be mentioned later in my constructive speech. And they didn't have an exact goal of their plan, which is they don't know how many soldiers they're going to conscript, which will be a lack of effectiveness in their plan. And they mentioned that the low birth rate is a problem in the Taiwan's military. However, the time of military service and the time suitable for women to give birth overlaps. So this will definitely affect Taiwan's low birth rate. Next, we're going to describe the composition of the military in Taiwan. The main battle force comprises volunteer service, including the Army, Navy, and Air Force. The reserve force, which assists when wars happen, is composed of retired voluntary soldiers. The garrison force is composed of obligatory soldiers. The affirmative team considers China's invasion and the defense of Taiwan as why we must force women to join the military. However, it will lead to the problem of wasting budget and make the military dismissive. Below shows how the affirmative team's plan fails and can be worked on. First, the affirmative teams can only react when wars happen. However, what we need to do is to prevent wars from happening. According to Taiwan's Trade Geopolitical Risk Index, cross-trade relationship became intense after 2016, when Taiwan changed its diplomatic strategies from being close to both China and the USA to being only friendly to the USA and not to China. Moreover, during Pelosi's visit in 2022, the index peaked. The rising index even led to the prolongation of the military training, which shows a higher demand of soldiers to defend Taiwan. This indicates that it is the change in diplomatic patterns that lead to the tension. Therefore, what we should do is to rebuild the balance in the past instead of resorting to war. We shouldn't incline to specific countries, but avoid war through proper diplomacy. Second, in terms of defending Taiwan and strengthening our military, the affirmative team fails again. Worse still, the military will be burdened with more soldiers than it needs in war. According to National Defense Secretary Zhang Guocheng, because of the geographical factors, we need a strong Navy and an Air Force to gain advantages in war. However, both of them are composed of voluntary soldiers, which means that the enhancement of the compulsory soldiers is useless. What we really need is to strengthen our military by increasing voluntary soldiers. Moreover, according to a legislative yuan and the Ministry of National Defense, the number of backup forces is sufficient. Consequently, the affirmative team's plan doesn't even solve the defense problem we really face, and this will undoubtedly burden our country and make our military less effective. Third, the affirmative team's plan will even promote more serious sexual harassment issues and affect the military's capabilities. According to FFI, in Norway, where women have been conscripted since 2015, 60% of women under 30 have once encountered sexual harassment in the military in 2020. In addition, women experience more sexual harassment and unwanted sexual attention than men. This shows the problem of forcing women to join the military. Moreover, Taiwan ranks 7th in gender inequality index, inferior to Norway at the rank of 2nd. According to the National Library of Medicine, gender inequality is linked with sexual harassment. This shows women in Taiwan are more likely to face inequality problems, and the situation in Taiwan's military could be worse. According to a RAND Military Workplace study, sexual harassment would make the military dismissive and unsupportive, which affects the military's readiness. Therefore, involving women in compulsory military training can not only cause sexual harassment problems, but also affect the military's capabilities. Next, let me briefly introduce our counter plan. First, what we need now is the main battle force composed of voluntary soldiers. So we're enlarging the number of voluntary soldiers. We will increase the salaries. The soldiers' minimum salaries will increase from 35,000 to 40,000 each month. Second, we're going to prevent wars from happening by applying suitable diplomatic strategies. We need to make sure we have stable communication channels to interact with other countries. Once we lower the tension, other countries will be more willing to have reliance on trade exchanges with us. In this case, we can not only assure our national security, but can better control our defense power. Based on the viewpoints above, we, the negative team, strongly disagree that Taiwan's compulsory military training should include both men and women. I'm ready for cross-examination. Thank you.
First affirmative cross-exams, first negative, 3 minutes.
Thanks for your speech. So first, can you talk about how are you going to manage the budget for your plan?
Well, we have evidence to show that we have enough budget for increasing voluntary
soldiers. Okay, thank you. And can you give us evidence about what the defense secretary said about Navy?
Okay, we can show you the evidence of Zhang Guozhen.
Okay, and you mentioned that you want to strengthen diplomatic relations with other countries. Is that right?
Well, mainly with China, because...
How are you going to lower the tension between Taiwan and China?
Well, first, we'll try to rebuild the balance in the past by applying the communication with China. And we will take the past as a working model and to apply ECFA as a way to communicate with China. And it includes the aspect of education and tourism and economy.
So can you make sure that I will prevent the war from happening?
Well, we can show you the evidence that it can lower the tension and rebuild the relationship between states.
Okay, and you mentioned that the backup soldier is not enough in Taiwan. Can you give us the evidence of that?
Yes, and the evidence comes from the Legislative Yuan and the Ministry of National Defense. It shows that our backup forces are about 230 million, which is enough for
and
the status quo.
Also, do you have a time frame to rebuild the diplomatic relations with China?
Well, we can lower the tension and we can successfully...
No, I mean a time frame. Like, do you have a... time, like how are you going to, when are you going to achieve your goal?
Well, it takes about 3 to 5 years to rebuild the balance. And also we are increasing the number of voluntary soldiers when in case a threat arises.
Okay. And should women have the same responsibility of protecting their own country as men?
Well, women also have the rights to defend our country and they can join the military through voluntary service.
What I mean is responsibility. So do they have the same responsibility as men?
Well, in the Constitution, it says that all citizens should do. But as I said, the society has changed. And not all laws of the Constitution are suitable. And some should be changed.
Okay. And also, you mentioned the sexual harassment in the military.
Yes.
Does your side have any plan to solve the sexual harassment problem in the military?
Well, the status quo already has its regulation to solve this problem. But in your plan, you're going to increase the number of female soldiers, and it will make the military's situation worse.
Okay. And how are you going to enlist more voluntary soldiers?
Well, we'll increase the salaries. And we can show the evidence that by increasing the salaries, we can effectively increase the number and the qualities of voluntary soldiers.
Okay, so can you give us evidence of that?
Sure.
And so are you going to strengthen which part of the voluntary soldier?
Well, like I said, the main battle force of Taiwan is composed of voluntary soldiers, and both are the Navy and Air Force. Thank you.
Second affirmative constructive speech, 5 minutes.
Greetings. First, I'll elaborate some of the points that the negative dropped. First of all, in their plan, they have nothing to help with the declining population. In addition, when we asked them for the evidence to prove that their budget is enough, they did not give it to us. And hence, we can conclude that their budget is not enough, and hence, their plan will fail. Now, I'll go over to my plan. Now, unlike our opponent's plan, which creates a lot of disadvantages and difficulties, which I'll review in the last part of my speech, our plan can solve the problems of unconstitutionality, low birth rate, and boost national defense all at the same time. Our first move is to rectify the law. As for the budget, the money for hiring more trainers and increasing or renovating the military camps has been covered in this year's national defense budget in preparation for next year's one-year military service. If other expenditures occur unexpectedly, the chief controller of the budget also said that we can use the first and second reserve funds of the executive yuan and the MND, while being 800 million and 7.42 billion respectively. Next, mandates. First mandate, a new division. MND should set out a new division that tackles the potential adjustment problems ranging from the insufficiency of training centers and teachers, increasing the number of female drill instructors, or modifying female uniforms or facilities to a counseling unit for dealing with all sorts of misfitting cases. Second, a mixed gender camp. We'll assign women to work and even share the same dormitory with men in basic training and military camps. It's based on Gordon Dow's research that my teammate has already elaborated on. Therefore, integrating women into traditionally male-dominated environments can significantly decrease male sexist attitudes and won't damage male combat capability, unlike what the negative is suggesting. Third, enforcement. We'll promote the idea that women can speak up without fear if they experience unwanted sexual contact. Those who initiated unwanted sexual contact or avoided compulsory drafts will be penalized based on the relevant laws. Also, we'll strictly enforce biannual investigations to guarantee the safety of female conscripts before gender equality becomes the norm in the military culture. Compare that to the negative plan. Their only plan is to rely on the regulations. That is wholly infeasible. If regulations will work, why is there still the problem of sexual harassment in today's society? Now, next, fourth, women's roles in the military. The Israeli IDF also says that there are 92% of positions open to women in the military, so the positions won't be a problem. Now, I'll go over why the negatives plan is infeasible. First of all, they wish to appeal to diplomacy and wish to use ECFA as a channel to communicate with China. However, ECFA is already on the brink of collapse, and we have evidence to prove that. China is already launching an investigation into Taiwan blocking around 20% of its products, which totals around 2,000. In addition, China has already notified Taiwan through WTO, and they are already launching an investigation. Next, diplomacy that succeeded in the past doesn't mean it can succeed now. There are many differences in the past compared to now, and the most important one being a different ruling party. In addition, the barrier for them to jump is definitely more challenging to compared to ours. Because of China's boycott, we have lost 9 diplomatic allies during President Tsai's period. Honduras was the recent one that severed its diplomatic ties with us last month. They could not provide a concrete way to start building a formal diplomatic relations with other countries. In addition, they stated that the time frame would be 3 to 5 years. However, we already stated with our evidence that China has the ability to launch an amphibious attack on us by 2027. Now it's already 2023, and with their 3 to 5 years time frame, we will definitely not make it to prevent China from attacking us. Next, budget. This year's national defense budget already covers hiring more trainers and increasing the number of military camps. So what the negative is suggesting that we do not have enough budget is definitely false. However, they want to raise the voluntary soldiers' salary. And we have already mentioned many times, despite various incentives, the goal of 90% of authorized end strength has never been reached. So just simply by providing incentives is definitely not enough. Also, according to Michael Hunziker's testimony before the US-China Economic and Security Review Commission, Taiwan's personnel salary accounted for 45% of its defense budget. However, before the implementation of the voluntary system, the salary cost only accounted for 26% of the defense budget. If they want to raise the voluntary soldiers' salary even more, then over half of the defense budget will be spent on personnel fees. Secondly, boosting air and navy forces costs a lot of money. We have evidence to prove that 66 F-16V fighters cost around $250 billion. If they want to boost our air and defense forces even more, and they will definitely need more money. So that will be the end of my speech. Thank you.
First, negative cross-exams. Second, affirmative. 3 minutes.
Below, I want to ask some questions.
Of course.
Right. You mentioned you will go through a biannual investigation in the military to protect women's rights, right?
It's not only to protect women's rights. It's to solve the problem of sexual harassment that you already mentioned.
Thank you.
We also agree that sexual harassment is a very serious problem in the military.
All right, thank you.
And that's why we will use the biannual investigations to solve it.
All right, then. Is doing it 2 years, 2 years on time enough for the status quo?
Well, what do you mean 2 years on time?
You do the investigation...
Biannual investigations means twice every year, not once 2 years.
All right, and then is it enough for the status quo?
What do you mean enough for the status quo?
Is it valid enough for the sex status quo?
Because aside from the biannual investigation, we also have evidence from Gordon Tao to prove that once we integrate women into the military, within just 8 weeks, their men will change their sexist attitudes
all right,
by 14%.
Can you show me the evidence of it?
Yes, of course.
All right, thank you. Then, do you have enough spaces for additional soldiers?
Yes, like I've already mentioned in my speech, the budget for renovating new training camps is already covered in this year's national defense budget, which is
I mean the spaces in Taiwan. Do you have enough spaces in Taiwan?
Yes, with the budget, we can definitely allocate more spaces, and we already have the budget to do it.
All right, can you show me the evidence of the budget?
Oh, of course.
Thank you. And you mentioned you have enough equipment for the soldiers, right?
We mentioned that there is budget to create more equipment for the soldiers.
All right, then where do the equipments come from?
What do you mean? Where do you buy
the equipments?
They will come from the current sources in the status quo. We will not change any of it.
And can you show me what is the current sources?
We are not sure of the current sources. However, we will...
All right, thank you.
All right.
Then, is the training set the same for both genders?
The basic training for both genders will be the same because we believe that in basic training is the fundamental of all of the military training. If they cannot even pass the basic training, they should not be in the military. And hence, basic training will be the same for both genders. In addition, we have evidence to prove that women are just as capable as men in basic training.
And show me the evidence of what you just said. And my next question is, can Taiwan defend itself with the compulsory soldiers you increase?
Taiwan can defend itself. First of all, there's an increase in soldiers. Second of all, we can send a signal to both international and internal. Like we have already stated, soldiers in Taiwan have low social status. And by recruiting women into the military,
we can
change that.
Can you ensure that other countries will definitely help us when in war?
Yes, we have evidence from RAND to prove that, a US think tank. So it's definitely credible.
All right, then show me the evidence of it.
All right.
Okay, my next question is Taiwan ready for war?
Is Taiwan ready for war? With the status quo, it is not. That's why we must recruit women.
All right, thank you.
Second negative constructive speech, 5 minutes.
Thanks for the affirmative speech. Below this, the second negative constructive speech. First, I would like to make some response to the affirmative team. First, that the affirmative team mentioned that women also have the responsibility to join the military because that's the constitution says so. However, the constitution says that everyone have the obligation to join the military. However, is that everyone have the obligation? Of course, for those who are aged as under 80 years old, that's they also don't have the obligation. So that's why the military acts need to consider the difference, the different physicality, the different situations for every person. So that's why we cannot have women in the military. And that's the reason why the military acts can do so. And also about the diplomatic aspects that the affirmative team curious about is that we work on ECFA. And they say that currently we already have ECFA. However, we have the evidence, we have already provided evidence that this comes from ECFA to prove that the situations for Taiwan to work on ECFA have decreased. So that's why we are going to take before as a working model to work on the aspects and to try to increase the amount of the ECFAs. And that's why we are going to work on this aspect, not as what the affirmative team just mentioned. And also about the problem of budget, they say that we didn't provide any evidence, but they didn't ask us for the evidence, but we do have the evidence. We were going to use the evidence, we are going to use the budget of the surplus of the current personnel budget, and we have the evidence proof that how many budgets we will need and how many budgets we have. And about their plans, they only provide the evidence that currently how many budget we have. However, currently, we are not recruiting women in the compulsory military service. So how can they use the current budget to prove that in the future they will have enough budget? And below is about their contention. They mentioned that is because the military act violates the constitution, so why we need to change the military act? However, in the cross-examination that the affirmative team also mentioned that it had been a long time ago, and also it might be not valid anymore. So what is the logic that the affirmative team tried to change the military act? And the problem is focused is on the constitution, but why the affirmative team tried to change the military act? And second aspect is their contention about the low birth rate. So, but through the whole debate, we cannot see the affirmative team provide. So how many soldiers will they need to in the future so to prove that it is enough? So since we don't know how many soldiers is enough, how can they say that it is not enough in the future? So, and second aspect is that my partner have already mentioned is that in their plan, they were even worse than the problem because the overlap between women to giving birth and the the age for women to join the military, it might even worsen the problem of low birth rate. So why the affirmative team tries to solve the problem of low birth rate by using the plan that they mentioned? So then the third aspect is about the emergency that they are trying to have a stronger military. However, we should not only focus on the quantity of our military. So, and we have already provided evidence that's come from logistic yuan to prove that the number will be enough. So actually, we need to go on how to strengthen our military by enhancing our quality of our military. So in our plan, we are going to increase the amount of voluntary soldiers, such as my partner have already mentioned, that is for those who are going to work on the main battle force. And that is that what we exactly need. Of course, backup soldiers are also important, but we have the evidence that's come from logistic yuan to prove that those backup soldiers have been enough. So that's the reason why we need to increase the amount of voluntary soldiers. But we're not going to change the total number. It is just try to use change those compulsory soldiers into the voluntary soldiers, so which means that we are trying to enhance the quality rather than the quantity that the affirmative team tries to do. And in their plan, there are two serious problems. Is that the affirmative team cannot mention that, for example, they are going to increase the amount of soldiers. So where will the equipment come from? And will the equipment enough? So are they going to just buy more equipment? And then where's the equipment will come from? And not showing any evidence or budgets that they will have enough to deal with the situation. So how can we know that after they join, have more women, but those women are just not having the equipment to work, to get into work. So, well, this will be valid. And the second aspect is about sexual harassment, that the affirmative team will have an annual investigation every two times 1 year. But the problem is that, would it be enough? The affirmative team didn't provide any evidence to prove that the annual investigation will be enough. And also, they are going to give women more chance to speak out when they are having the when they are facing sexual harassment. However, the current government also have the two notes for women to speak out. So we didn't see that the affirmative team do any efforts to work on the problem of sexual harassment, but they just say that their plans can solve the problem. All right, thank you.
Second affirmative cross-exams, second negative, 3 minutes.
So are you aware that there's already an investigation going on about Taiwan violating ECFA?
Yes, but the problem, we have the evidence to prove that the number of it have decreased.
I'm talking about how are you so sure that if the investigation passed, ECFA will not be abolished? Because we have evidence to prove that it might be abolished in the future.
But we didn't see the evidence provided. We didn't
right.
see the evidence.
So now, with ECFA, with ECFA, how will you ensure that China will no longer continue to engage combat with us?
I need to mention is that we are trying our best to prevent war from happening, and we are going to work on not only the ECFA, but also as the aspects of economic, aspects of education, as the aspects of tourism. And we are trying our best to have more communication with China, and that's the first aspect.
All right.
And the second aspect is about the voluntary soldiers. Because he who wants peace prepare for war, only we have a stronger army, a better military, is that we can have more chance to communicate with other countries. So that's our plan is combined together, and we are sure that we will try our best.
Now, you stated that you will resort to regulations and the current status quo for the dealing with sexual harassment. Now, let me ask you this. If the current status quo is so good, why is there still sexual harassment going on?
I think you misunderstood our opinion. Our opinion is that if you increase the amount of women in the compulsory military service, the problem will be worse.
Do you have evidence to prove that?
Yes, we have the evidence. That's come from Norway, which have already have women in the military for such a long time, and the sexual harassment is still very serious, and we have the evidence.
Can you give us the evidence for your budget? Because you did not provide us with it the last time. All right, now, you mentioned that you should raise the salary of conscripts. How much will you raise it by?
You mean how many?
How much, what will the salary of conscripts be after you raise it?
Here
is. Or do you not have an exact
number?
Here
is the salaries. Right. And the salaries will go to, everybody will increase about 5,000. Here, the evidence have showed that.
5,000, all right. You mentioned that, how will your plan promote gender equality?
Gender equality, is that?
Yes.
In our plan, we are not going to worsen the problem.
That is why. That is different. But how will you solve? How will you promote gender equality? Because with our plan, we can promote gender equality. How will your plan do that?
All right. So in our opinion, is that we are sure in your plan, you will not promote the gender equality.
How? Why? Do you have evidence?
Yes, we have very good evidence.
So now, how will your plan deal with the gender equality?
So in our plan, as a negative team, we're just trying to say that we should not do so because in your plan, you are even worse than the problem. But the problem of promote gender equality is not what we exactly need to do.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
First negative rebuttal speech, 3 minutes.
Thanks for the affirmative speech. Below is the first negative rebuttal speech. First, I would like to point out some mistakes the affirmative team has made. The first one is about the budget. The affirmative team provided the evidence of how much the budget is in the status quo. However, the status quo doesn't conscript women. Therefore, we can't ensure whether the budget is enough or not when they started conscripting women. And this indicates that their evidence on the budget is a lack of consideration. Moreover, the affirmative team used the budget to increase the number of compulsory soldiers. And as we mentioned before, the main battle force which we are in need of is composed of voluntary soldiers. And we already provided the evidence that the backup forces is enough in a status quo. Therefore, their plan is a lack of effectiveness and is a total waste of budget. Next, the age of military service in a status quo is from 18 to 33 years ago. And we have evidence to prove that the suitable age for women to give birth is from 25 years old to 35 years old. And due to the overlap between these two, the affirmative team's plan will affect the low birth rate they're trying to solve. And this is stoning themselves on their foot. And their contention is a lack of logic. And also, about the gender equality, they try to improve the gender equality problems in Taiwan by conscripting women into the military. However, we have provided the evidence that in Norway, where women have been conscripted, the sexual harassment problems have become more serious. And according to the ranking of gender inequality index, Taiwan is inferior to Norway, which means that women in Taiwan are more likely to face gender inequality problems. And the situation in Taiwan's military could be worse. This means the military will be more affected by the sexual harassment cases in Taiwan, and which all affect the military's readiness. And therefore, their plan can enhance the national defense of Taiwan. And I would like to answer some questions about how we are going to lower the tension. We will conduct the ECFA, and it includes three aspects. It's about the education and the tourism and the economy. And we have evidence to prove that this can surely lower the tension. And also, when the threat arises, we have enough voluntary soldiers to defend Taiwan. Because as the saying goes, he who wants peace prepares for a war. That's why we need to increase the number of voluntary soldiers. And let me compare both sides' plan. Both of us are aware of the invasion of China, and they try to increase the number of compulsory soldiers, and which is not helpful for the status quo because the compulsory soldiers is not the main battle force. And we try to increase the voluntary soldiers, which is the main battle force. And we try to apply diplomacy to lower the tension. And we are solving the problem from the root of it. Thank you.
First affirmative rebuttal speech, 3 minutes.
Greetings. In my speech, first I would like to point out some of the drop arguments our opponents did. So they did not answer our rebuttal about how they are going to enlist more voluntary soldiers with the existing budget for voluntary soldiers' salary is so high. And also, it did not answer our question about their contention about appeal to diplomacy. And now I move on to our rebuttal. So first, they say that if we want to recruit women, we have to have equipment for them. However, budget of having buying new equipment has already in the defense budget for the next year. And also, we have evidence to prove that women can also take on other positions in the military, jobs like human resources units, logistical corps, helping with maintenance, law enforcement duties, media relations are all positions they can take on. And next, they did not really understand our rebuttal about ECFA. So what we're trying to say is that ECFA is already in collapsing, so if they want to use FRS, a communication path to China, it may not work. And so they cannot ensure if they can really prevent the war from happening. However, our plan can have more soldiers in the military, and we can make sure that there will be enough people in the military. And also, as we mentioned, even though they say that the backup soldier now is enough, however, due to the low birth rate, there might not be enough soldiers in the future. And next, they say that women in the military will not have have time to give birth to people, and also it will cost it will cause a low birth rate. However, the disadvantages of that has existing and can never be caused by our plan. Even without compulsory service, according to household registration, women get married at 30 on average. Therefore, the negative is making a non-unique argument. And also, the women will only stay in the military for a year. So how can that affect our fertility rate? And next, they did not understand how we're going to make sexual harassment, how we're going to lower sexual harassment. However, as we mentioned, we have evidence from Norway, and it conduct that with integration women with men, there will be 14% men increase in trusting women and not denying their feminine traits. So we have to integrate them together. And now I want to compare evidence from both sides. So our evidence is from Gordon Dell's research work with the whole Norwegian army, and it explains the cost of sexual harassment in the military. And we have another major from South Korea to prove that women are capable of protecting our country. On the other side, they use one of their main contention is to use volunteer soldier, the Navy and Marine to defend our country. However, it is only based on Zhang Guochen's quote, and the resource of them is from a news, which is third-hand or second-hand resource. And now, to conclude, our plan solves the problem of negative population growth rate, and we address the injustice for only drafting men in the status quo. And now this is the end of my speech. Thank you.
Second negative rebuttal speech, 3 minutes.
Thanks for the affirmative speech. Below this, the second negative rebuttal speech. First, I would like to make some response to the affirmative team. That they mentioned that the evidence that is about Zhang Guochen is a person that's who are not being able to prove that. But the problem is that Zhang Guochen is the national defense security. So we are sure that because the evidence is to prove that how the wars might going on. So as the national defense security, we are sure that he is a professor to deal with the situation. And also the second aspect is that the affirmative team saying that we are not providing any evidence to prove that about the salaries and the budgets will be too much. But we have already provided evidence and we have counted. So how many budget will we need and how many budget we have. And in the evidence have already showed this very clearly. And the second and the third aspect is about the ECFA. The affirmative team keeps saying that ECFA is in collapse, but the problem is that they ask us in the cross examination, if they point it out in the cross examination and not providing any evidence and want us to answer the question. But the problem is that we didn't see any evidence. How can we answer the question that, well, ECFA is in collapse or something? And the affirmative team keep drop out from the main point of today's debate. They keep saying that in our plan, we cannot promote gender equality. But to reach gender equality, we have many ways. For example, in education. For example, in the society, we can do many things to deal with the situation. But as a negative team, we have already provided evidence to prove that in their plan, they will not promote gender equality and will even worsen the problem. Let's just take Norway, for example. Both of our team use Norway as evidence. But in our evidence, it is the exact number of how many women and how the rate of how many women are, say, facing the problem of sexual harassment. But in their evidence, that is just a survey, that is just a prediction. It's just that the rate can be decreased. But also, sexual harassment is not only about the rate, but the number will surely be increased because more women will face sexual harassment. And about the budget, that they keep using the evidence that currently how many budget we have. But currently, we are not conscripting women in the military. How can you just use the current budget to prove that in the future we will have enough budget? And about to strengthen our military, we are sure in our plan we will be better because we have already provided evidence to prove that the number have been enough. So what we need to focus on is to enhance the quantity, the quality of our military. And we have already mentioned in our plan we will increase more voluntary soldiers and that we have already proved the importance of the voluntary soldiers and the compulsory soldiers. And about the problem of low birth rate, that we cannot see the affirmative team say how many soldiers they need. So how can we know that, well, it be lack of soldiers or something? And what is the difference in this aspect is that we have, in our plan, we can be more valid and to knowing that what exactly we need, because we know how many soldiers we need to defend Taiwan and how many soldiers we have. So we prove that the soldiers will be enough. All right, that is my speech. Thank you.
Second affirmative rebuttal speech, 3 minutes.
Greetings. So I would like to first point out that the negatives say we do not give them the evidence for ECFA. However, that is ridiculous because ECFA was first cited during my constructive speech. However, when they cross-examined me, they did not ask for the evidence, and that's why we did not provide it for them. How can they expect us to provide the evidence for them that they did not even ask for? So their argument is ridiculous. Now, I'll summarize the points of this debate. First of all, whose plan will cost money? Second of all, the problem of national defense. And the third of all, gender equality and whose plan can solve the problem of sexual harassment. First, whose plan will cost more money? We have already stated numerous times that in order to implement our plan, the budget is already enough. And if there is unexpected expenditures, we can use the first and second reserve fund, which is 800 million and 7.42 billion. This was already stated many times. However, for the negatives plan, they plan to boost air and marine defense forces and also increase the voluntary soldiers' salary to 40,000. First of all, boosting air and marine defense forces, MND has already used a special budget of $237 billion to boost air and marine defense forces. Also, like I've already mentioned in my constructive speech, personnel cost already accounts for 45% of the defense budget compared to 26% in the past. Next, national defense. For our plan, we can not only boost the overall military strength, we can also send a signal to other countries, and this is supported by the evidence from RAN. However, the negatives stated that they want to use an already dying plan, which is ECFA, to support their diplomacy. I've already stated, by simply boosting voluntary forces by increasing their salary is definitely not enough, as MND has already provided various incentives for voluntary soldiers in the military. However, the ratio of extra strength to authorized strength has never reached its goal of 90%. This was also mentioned many times. Next, gender equality and who can solve the problem of high sexual harassment. First of all, gender equality. We believe that the affirmative plan is obviously superior in this aspect because we plan to promote formal equality, which is that men and women get the same things. This form of equality is often regarded as true equality, as people will get the same things no matter their differences. And we have also provided evidence to prove that women are not inferior to men in any way. We have 3 pieces of evidence to prove that. In addition, the negative only wants to solve the problem of sexual harassment through the implementation of regulations. However, we have already stated that that is definitely not enough. With our plan, we have cited Gordon Dow's research that already proves with the implementation of women, the number of sexual harassment will definitely decrease. And we have also given the exact number and given them the evidence card for that. That will be the end of my speech. Thank you.
That's the end of this debate. Now it is time for judges to give up some comments.
All right, when we were judging this debate, we thought there were 2 main issues that needed to be dealt with by the debaters. And these 2 issues were the issues of national defense and gender inequality. And Eric over here is going to talk to the debaters about the issue of national defense first.
Thank you, Michael. So as for national security, the key issues for the affirmative side is that you have to persuade us that including women in compulsory military training will increase Taiwan's national security. For the negative side, you will have to mention and you have to persuade us with evidence that communication with China, a non-democratic country, will lower the risk of military invasion. But in general, both teams did a great job and provide some good evidence and asked some good questions. Thank you.
So now it's over to me with the gender inequality. One of my favorite things to do in any debate is to use somebody else's argument against them, which is something that I felt really could have happened here. Because gender inequality doesn't necessarily mean sexual harassment. It was kind of being used that way. And pointing out how Taiwan currently has a bigger problem with gender inequality versus Norway, which has less of a problem, that's wonderful, because you're trying to say we want women in the military to create more gender equality, because right now there is a problem. They're pointing out how there's essentially a imbalance of equality here, and you're saying, hey, we're making it more balanced. We're solving that problem that you yourself are pointing out, which is essentially, you know, stabbing and twisting the knife, which I think is great if you can do that. So I think you have to be careful how you use your terms. Gender inequality versus sexual harassment, they are different. That's my main things. Back to you, Michael.
And so one thing I want to do is to encourage you to try to have positive material. And so what I heard a lot of in this debate is something that was just very negative, or you're not able to do this, or you don't have this kind of evidence, or can you show me the evidence that, for example, you're two reviews a year about sexual harassment will be enough. And then what I actually want to hear, instead of just the questioning that something is not going to work, is some kind of proposal that tells me what actually is going to work. And so that's what I'm going to hear from both sides. And this is what I think will be more effective in terms of argumentation. So if you can say that their budget is not enough, instead of just saying that, tell me what their budget can accomplish. You can say, for example, that you claim that you're able to recruit maybe 20,000 soldiers, but when we look at your numbers, we can show you can only recruit 5,000, and that's only a quarter of the number that you claim. So if you can give me something like that, something concrete, that would be more convincing to me, because as I'm sitting here listening to you, I don't have access to all your numbers. So it'd be actually really helpful if you can come to the conclusion, say what the effect is. And so what I really want to commend both sides on is how much work you put in. And so the negative side is claiming that diplomacy is going to work. And so what I want to know is the effect of diplomacy. And so for both sides, you're saying that we're going to increase soldiers and this is going to make us stronger in terms of national defense. And, you know, if I'm judging this issue, I'd have to say I can't really be sure who's going to win on that issue. But in terms of something like gender equality, I think the affirmative side is much stronger, because they're actually trying to do something. They're trying to do something to bring women in. And so maybe the women will be sexually harassed some more. But in terms of men, for example, this is a gender equality issue. Like, if men have to serve in the military, why don't women have to? And so definitely affirmative is dealing with the issue of gender equality. And so I think they're slightly stronger on that side.
Thank you, judges. Thank you, debaters. Now, that's a wrap.
What a debate! There are many clashes and exciting moments. Do you want to talk about it?
Well, yeah, even though it was a great debate, but I think I have to work on my flow. Like, it could have been better in my rebuttal speech.
Well, for me, I think that our time management could be a little better. And in addition, I think that, like the judges have said, there are two main topics of this debate, national defense and gender equality. I feel like that we could have focused on gender equality a little bit more and, balance things out.
Yeah, that's a valuable suggestion for the affirmative team. Since we are joined this debating for a while, so are there any valuable lessons you want to share with?
I think I learned the most is critical thinking. By understanding multiple perspectives on an issue, and also we learn how to weigh out solvencies due to different issues and make it better.
So I think English debate improved my oral skills and also the critical thinking. And I think I can have a different point of view from others, and that really changed my life.
Yeah, that's really an important ability to build a future citizen. I'm so happy we're a team. And since we have finished this long, long day.
Okay. Peter, as a senior debater, what do you think is the most important skill as a debater?
It feels like the skill of critical thinking is very important because as a strategy that the opponents will try their best to maybe drop off on the topic because it might help them win. But if this time you have the critical thinking that it will help you to focusing on the topic today and try our best to win a debate, and that is.
Andy?
I personally think that the English skills are one of the most important skills in English debate because we're debating in a total foreign language and this requires a lot of training and efforts to it.
Nice. And Julia, how do you feel?
I think teamwork is also an important thing because we have only 1 minute preparation time and we need to discuss to each other in a short time.
And how do you feel about your performance today, Peter and Andy?
It feels like I'm very enjoying today's debate and of course, thanks to the judges that I know that many aspects maybe we can work on to become better. And I'm very happy to face the fellow debaters and I'm very happy about today's debate.
Andy.
So I think this is a great opportunity to promote English debate in Taiwan. And I also appreciated the judges' effort and all the coaches and the host.
The journey's journey, the debate journey. Do you have any visions you think you have gotten so far?
Well, the school really helped us a lot. They formed this group and trained us for almost 4 months. And they have put a lot of effort into it. And so did we. So we should be proud of ourselves.
Lastly, Peter?
I'm very appreciative to the whole debate, the host of the debate and policy debate, because that is a very good chance for us to know another thing that we cannot learn from the education that the school gives us.
This is the end of our policy debate journey, and congratulations, it did so well.
Thank you for watching YouthSpeak special program, an exhibition debate on policy. If you enjoyed this program, follow and subscribe to TaiwanPlus for more. See you next time.